everybody, to the Mandablorian podcast, the only toy and weed podcast that I know of. The show where me and my like-minded friends do two of our favorite things, talk about nerd stuff, and smoke the weed. So let's get right down to business. Owner and proprietor of Access Cannabis, hailing all the way from Spokane, Washington, we have Wayne Fort.
Hello there.
What are you smoking tonight, Wayne?
Tonight I've got some jelly biscuit live resin diamond sauce from the old tycoon guy.
Sounds delicious.
Hello.
That's what it looks like. It's a company that we used to carry a couple of years ago. And I guess the license has changed hands and the new owners have come out swinging and wanted to make an impression with some really killer stuff. So
awesome.
It's nice to be my first time trying it since it's been brought back to the store.
Diamonds, dude.
Points.
Guy's best friend in this case.
Oh my god, dude.
Looks like crack rocks.
What crack rocks look like, Kyle?
I don't know. I've seen pictures. I've never seen, like, I've seen tons of drugs, obviously, but I've never seen crack in person. Never.
Stop smoking crack, Kyle.
Stop smoking. It's out there.
Hailing all the way from Denver, the Last Dinosaur, Colorado, Christopher Sturr.
Oh, shit.
Getting white girl wasted today.
Yeah. Them white claws.
It's the same.
This is called, but it's the same thing I've had the last like fucking so many weeks, dude. Like,
and from Minsk. The dirty, dirty D in Midwest USA, the 13th member of D12, still freshly shorn. I guess you're growing it back a little bit.
It's been a week or so, and something like that. So, like, stubbly stubbles.
You gonna shave it, or are you just gonna keep it going?
I don't know. I mean, it's short right now.
Well, stubble actually looks pretty good too, though. Sometimes. So.
Yeah, I mean, that's actually the one thing I've noticed is that, like, when I walk out of the stores and take the mask off, that like I've been getting some looks from some of the ladies around town. So, like, that's been kind of
nice. Good. Yeah.
Nice feet right here and right here. Boy.
I gotta shave. I haven't shaved all fucking. I usually shave on Tuesdays. Like, I do my whole head and everything on Tuesdays, and I didn't get to it this week, and I just kept not doing it. So I gotta fucking. Anyway, Nico Tronis, that's your name.
That is my name.
What an intro.
And from Allentown, Pennsylvania, I am Brother Kyle.
Hey, motherfucker. Oh,
what do you got tonight? What are you smoking tonight, by the way?
You smoking these nuts, bitch. I've just got the THCA from the dispensary. I would show it, but it's I have such a small amount left in my jar that if I was to lift it up, and I don't want it. So
yeah, don't
do that.
And I have some flour that I was, again, last week tipped with. Somebody tipped me. Well, they gave me money, too, but they also gave me weed, which is awesome. This stuff is called it's called Jaeger, actually, like the drink. And I also have some
what?
CBD THC in my system right now too. And that stuff is a miracle worker.
Sounds good.
It's fired up. Ago,
Jesus.
There was a there was a Winter Soldier, Falcon and Winter Soldier episode, and honestly, I can't remember even what happened. I remember liking it. Was that was the one? And we talked about the one where they went to Madripoor, right?
Yeah, that was where he did that thing at the end to the guy.
Yeah, that one with that thing.
No, the one where it was the one where they they fight Carly and the other people, and John Walker ends up killing.
Yeah, that shit was actually pretty.
Yeah,
I didn't see that coming. I was like, holy shit, like, fuck, dude.
Zemo was really committed to destroying that super soldier serum. You'd think that, you know, him being the bad guy, that he would have some alternative motive. And he didn't even think twice. He saw those vials on the ground and he just fucking went for it. But one got away.
Yeah.
I actually really like Zemo in this series, dude. They're fleshing him out good. And you didn't really know who he was in the Civil War movie. He's just some dude you see for, like, maybe, 10 minutes of screen time, tops?
Probably not, even.
Find a gif to put up.
But he's good, dude, and he fist pumps. Zemo cut already came out, dude. Like, bro.
I mean, they had to put something out. They have literally nothing going on in this fucking show, and it's all fucking woke SJW garbage, so... Yeah. Let's put out an hour video of Zemo fist bumping and looking in different directions, and we'll just put it to some generic dance music. And this Marvel shit is getting really fucking stupid. And I'm bothered by is the fact that WandaVision was the first step into this nonsense, and it's continuing, and it hasn't stopped, and it's not stopping. It's going to continue being woke garbage and telling you that you should all go find your black friends and stick a hand out and say, I'm sorry for things that I've never done to you, but I'm sorry for things that, you know, shitty people in the world have done to you. You should go out and do that. Just like Bucky did to Sam.
Well, maybe I will.
Did you do that?
Yeah.
Didn't he say?
Yeah. I'm
sorry. And handed him the shield. And Falcon, thank you. And took the shield. And
I thought he was saying sorry for like talking shit for giving the shield up.
No. He was apologizing.
Maybe I misunderstood the scene.
He was apologizing for him and Steve putting him in the position to be a black Captain America.
Yeah. It's like, I'm sorry that it's mine and Steve's fault, Falcon, who was born 100 years after we were, that we existed before your time, so that now the bar is so impossibly high that you absolutely cannot reach that bar because, A, you're not a super soldier, and B, you know, you're just a guy. And, like, on top of that, you're also black. So you'll never be up here with Steve or Bucky, but, you know, I'm sorry for that. I'm sorry that the world did that.
Okay, yeah, I didn't understand the scene then, I guess, because I don't know, that's just what I thought, but...
Yeah.
I actually do have a question about that, because you guys, have you read when Steve, motherfucking Sam was Captain America? Have you read any of that stuff? Did he have any super soldier stuff in him, or...
Not
enough. He was just a dude.
Same story. Yeah. So he's like,
I still had wings, right?
The stuff and...
Yeah, he still has wings.
Okay.
Like, I have a feeling that's what we're gonna see. Like, that's what Bucky had the Wakandans make for him was Captain America vibranium suit with vibranium wings.
And of course they fucking Pulp Fictioned us on the briefcase.
Yeah.
I don't want to see the soul.
I actually think it'll probably look pretty cool. Well, I mean, obviously.
It should look cool. I'm sure of that.
Aesthetically, anything, anyway. Yeah.
This shit's dope, dude. The visuals and stuff on the show, I like. I'm enjoying it.
Figure arts pre-order to go up next week for $190.
Yeah, that's not
$190.
I mean, the new Falcon they just put up a pre-order from the show for is $150 or $160.
Yeah, why are they charging so much, dude?
Because he has wings. I don't know. It's so weird.
They're they're milking it because they're spending less time, less energy, and less sculpting in everything they're doing right now. All the heads look terrible. The bodies don't look that great. And then the fact that, like, up until a year ago, you could still get that Infinity War Falcon on Amazon for like $60.
Yeah.
So
easy. Yeah.
How do you tack on another 90 for something like that? It's just stupid.
It's a little crazy. And that, and his face sculpt is not good. The only saving grace for the face sculpt is the one where he has the goggles on, because you can't really see, you know, the face
itself. Yeah.
Yeah. So that's actually cool. A decent figure though. But yeah, not fucking $160 decent.
I saw a thread in some of the SHF groups, and it was like, are the face sculpts getting progressively worse?
Everybody was like, yeah, dude, fuck.
Yeah, I mean, it
kind of
sucks,
dude.
Bummer, man.
That's the frightening thing, is, like, if you look at, like, the legends, like, look at that fat Thor that's coming. Dude, that looks so fucking good.
Yeah, it looks better.
You compare that.
It really does.
SHF.
It looks great, dude.
Yeah. What are you going to fucking do if you have a $70 figure in front of you and the $20 Hasbro version, and the fucking $20 Hasbro version looks better than the Japanese import?
I'll guarantee you it stands and everything better too. It'll have ankles.
Probably.
That fucking work with his shins. Like, dude, that buying that figure kind of got me out of, like, buying MCU stuff.
Yeah. Understand. Dude,
this figure kind of sucks.
Back to the show real quick. I kind of did like how they did John Walker, like, in this episode. I kind of like his little speech that he gave, where he was, you know, they're still kind of, like, seems to me, like, flipping back and forth for me anyway, where I'm like, is this, like, am I sympathetic toward this guy? And then he does something, I'm like, yeah, you're an asshole. But then when he has something like that, where he's basically telling him, he's like, look, like, just think of it like this. Like, if you were in the middle of a fucking battle and somebody killed your best friend, like, you'd probably flip the fuck out too.
Oh yeah, especially with all that serum, dude. Like,
yeah. And then he's basically saying, like, look, you guys, like, you trained me, you built me, you pointed me in the directions, and then I do something that got caught on a camera phone, and now what? Now you're just, like, booting me to the fucking door, and I guess it's not really right. And kind of fucked up.
It was interesting that they go out of the way to say that, you know, if you hadn't been recorded, more or less, if you hadn't been recorded, then yeah, it probably would have been fine. But being recorded was the act that got you busted.
Yeah, and it's honestly believable that they would do that.
Mm-hmm. And I think that was the whole, the agent, the woman that came. What was her name?
Contessa Valentina. She had like four names. It was weird. How crazy was that though? I didn't see that coming at all. Right. I didn't hear any rumors or nothing. Maybe Nico, when he comes back, I don't know, because he's usually on top of a lot of that shit.
Yeah, I didn't hear anything about that. Dude, that was the last thing I expected to see, was fucking Elaine.
Had you heard any, like, rumors about that, Nico?
I mean, I had heard that there was going to be
I was wondering what you were getting at. Totally worth it. When she said that line about the boots, was that like a line from Seinfeld?
Which line?
I don't know. It's actually a pretty good Jerry Seinfeld face, though.
What is the deal?
What's the deal?
What's the deal with Hydra?
I think that was like an Easter egg from a Seinfeld. I think she said that was like a line from Seinfeld or something that she had. I don't know. I actually don't know much about that show. So.
Yeah, I mean, I like Seinfeld, but yeah, I don't know. Like, I know, like, Sonny and shit like that.
I'm going to throw it out there and just say that it was just a stupid throwaway line that was meant to introduce her because she was wearing retarded-looking boots. And she was, you know.
So you probably know a little bit about that character, I assume. I don't know. She was a agent for S.H.I.E.L.D. or something?
It really doesn't fucking matter at this point because, you know, it's Julia Louis-Dreyfus and she's a fucking comedy actress. And that was supposed to be a big cameo in the episode. So, like, after they learned their lesson from WandaVision and the way fucking Paul Bettany, you know, ran his mouth talking about a Luke Skywalker-style cameo.
Oh, yeah.
They like, toned it all way, way, way down. And, like, I'm just, you know, over everything they're doing right now.
One more episode.
Yeah, is that it? There's
one more? One more, last one. And, like, even worse, like, all of this shit set up. Here's what I'm expecting in the next episode. Little girl Envy's Nest is gonna get arrested. Sam's boat's gonna get blown up. We might see old man Steve show up in like a brief little 10-second cameo.
Like a force nod from across the hallway.
something like that. Yeah. Or you know, he'll be like driven up to, you know, a street corner and Sam will just be standing there all pouty and shit. And you know, window will fucking roll down and you know, he's like
smoke coming, smoking a joint in the car. Hey, Sam!
What if
it's Steve and Snoop Dogg and they're asking fat ass tarantulas back and forth, and Steve's all
Joe Rogan
left, and Falcon's all, yo, my name's Clarence, can I get a ride? And Steve's
all, fuck free world, and drives off.
Steve's all, no, I don't think you will. And he puts the fuck off.
Sounds like we get old man Steve cameos instead of Stan Lee now from here on out.
That might be what happens.
That'd be kind of funny.
I would actually love that, dude.
Yeah.
I actually would probably like that more than it being Deadpool.
Man, that sucks. I always forget. I don't have to think about that. Like, no more Stan Lee cameos. That really sucks.
I want to say that there were still one or two that they still had in the cam.
Would you like them to do that, like a CGI, like a? I don't think that would be good. I'd rather just.
It wouldn't be terrible, but I think that like they could use him in different ways, like not necessarily as like a character. They could like put his face in the clouds in the background,
like fucking Lion King style.
Or no,
maybe someone has like a photo of their desk or
like just making it be like there he is looking down on his stories or his characters or his creations, but not making it so obvious that you're just like, holy shit, it's fucking Stan Lee's head floating in the sky. Like I don't want him to look like Mac Tonight on those old Metallica commercials. It's
yeah.
Back tonight was the shit.
Fucking shit. Yeah, the drape going, dude.
Oh, man.
I mean, when you got that the point, best. You kind of got some kind of drape.
The toy line from the whole Mac Tonight line was fucking bomb, dude. Hold that car.
That's crazy. The shit in the 80s and the early 90s like that happened at all.
Oh man.
The fucking mascot for a fucking sandwich. Not even a fucking mascot for the entire restaurant, because they already had Ronald. There's Ronald everywhere.
But right.
Fucking it's a moon with sunglasses and
it just comes and he's just vibing, dude.
Fucking moon.
Yeah, no.
Let's go to Sinatra.
That was fucking weird.
Probably took a lot of cocaine.
Oh, in the 80s, no.
I honestly think they need to start using cocaine and start writing good movies again, because it's obviously lack of cocaine that's
sucking
creativity out of I mean, even in like, I mean, geez, even the kids' movies, like we had Never Ending Story and Labyrinth and Gremlins. And like, when is the last time you saw a movie as good as just say fucking Gremlins, even? And that's just a generic by the numbers, you know, story. Gremlins 2 wasn't even as good as the first one, but a classic movie and fairly well acted for its time. And you can't touch it now. Like, and anything to go anywhere near it is just like, there's just cash grab bullshit.
And clearly everything about those types of movies, like real drugs were involved. Like this was a day and age where it wasn't just a part of the writing team. Real drugs were everywhere back then, like on set, in the taxi, on the plane,
at the middle of the scene.
Yeah, absolutely. Like, you know they had
fake cocaine.
You know they had Gizmo doing fucking lines, and he was like, then you had a fucking coked up hand for your fucking hand puppet. Frank Oz was like, shit. Yeah, it's more coke I'll do here.
Get down, do you? Hey, so like in the future, when the production companies come up in Oregon, and you know, because all drugs got legalized there, and really good movies start happening there, like maybe they'll start paying attention again. I don't know, but
they all got legalized.
Bring back that '80s coke. Please to the set writers and movie makers, my God.
Yes, those are the guys that need it most, because
give it to them. The rest of us don't need it. I don't need it personally.
No,
not in a pod store. I wouldn't touch it. But you know, give it to those guys, please.
Well behind me.
Everyone in entertainment needs that shit, because the problem is right now they're eating too much soy. They're having too much soy milk and almond milk and all kinds of other nut milks, and that's not providing the needed benefits for the full creative process. They're lacking a lot.
I like almond milk. I also take supplements on the side, though, so I'm not...
Stop drinking that, dude. Shit's poison.
Ah, it's good. I only put in coffee anyway, actually. So
I will say for the show that at least it's doing a decent job portraying the other side, the Flag Smashers and Carly's point of view. It's kind of redundant that she kind of always goes back to basic tropes, you know, at the end of little speeches and things. But we get a few, you know, peeks into...
Teach him a lesson, all right, mate. We going to teach him a lesson.
Isn't it?
This little British orphan Annie fucking looking teenager bitch who suddenly, all of a sudden, the world's greatest terrorist, the fucking winter fucking soldier, the white wolf, and fucking Falcon are afraid of a fucking two-year-old? What?
Well, she's really strong, though.
These nuts are really strong.
Two-year-old.
Yeah, that is kind of like a little weird. Like there's no explanation. I mean, actually, the guys that were fighting, I think they had talked about doing like old military or mercenary work or something. But like, yeah, where does she learn how to fight? Because yeah, she's strong, but that shit only gets you so far when you're fighting somebody that knows how to fight.
When I was in the orphanage, I had to fight for the last piece of bread and the last piece of cheese, and that's where I got my fighting skills. And my fighting skills are right up there with all the terrorists in the world. That's what I'm
saying. Back to him, I can believe. So that's the thing that happened. We found out that Sharon Carter was actually the one that, did I get that right? She actually was the one that hired him to do that. Initially, the mission that they started the show with, which was
silly pal.
So I guess kind of like the big reveal now is who's going to be like the power broker. Is it going to be Elaine, or is it going to be Sharon? Maybe.
I saw a thing where, so like with the whole Apple thing, like they won't let any bad guys have iPhones, and I guess Sharon has a fucking Galaxy.
Oh, spoilers.
I never heard that. Dude. That's weird.
Yeah, and I don't know if that's true. I'm going to go back and watch all of them. But I guess all the bad guys have Android and the heroes have iPhones. I've noticed all the guys on like Avengers all have like iPhones.
That's weird.
But...
dang.
I never paid attention to bad guys' phones.
Wow.
But that's what this thing said. I'm like,
spoilers.
Weird. That's incredible.
That's if that ends up being the case. I mean, even if Peggy Maysu Carter ends up being the fucking the whatever the fuck, the who gives a shit. This shit's disappointing. Like when you look back at like Captain America 2, Winter Soldier, and how impressive that movie is and how like well written it is. The stuff is garbage. It's like, dude, literally they went to Russo's office and they were like, quick, let's go to the bathroom and see if we can find any toilet paper with shit on it that hasn't been flushed yet.
No
matter how many times I've seen it, dude, like that Winter Soldier movie, so many parts, dude. The captain's orders, you're like, oh shit. Yeah. Like it just gets you, dude, like every time.
Mm-hmm.
So
and this ain't that. But I mean, that being said, I'm enjoying this show, but it ain't fucking that movie.
I was just gonna say too, because sure. I think I learned my lesson a little bit from Wakanda or fucking WandaVision. That so no, like I had such
vision. That sounds like something we all want to see.
Wakanda,
I want to know like when Shuri goes out for, you know, fast food.
I still like that show, but I was disappointed because my expectations were so high. There was going to be all these big crazy reveals and things that tie into other things, and I didn't go into this show with any of those expectations. I was just going into it like not expecting to be like blown away by, you know, like an X-Men reveal or some stuff like that, which actually we are kind of getting some X-Men stuff in this one. I'm looking forward to next week, just hoping that it's going to be a nice, like a cool battle anyway, with the kind of
nice wrap up.
I did like the fight, the Captain America fight at the beginning of this last week's episode, where they took the shield.
Dope. John Walker, yeah.
Broke his arm to take the shield. That was a badass fight.
Oh, actually. When Ayo, how do you pronounce it? When she like did her little 5-point palm exploding heart technique thing on his shoulder. Yeah, that was pretty dope.
Mm-hmm.
That was the previous one. Yeah, that was insane, right. Dude.
So, you know, Marvel's kind of doing what Marvel does well, and, you know, kind of sucking at what they suck at, I guess.
It's Disney, I'd say, more than anything, kind of.
Yeah, I mean, like, across the board, viewership is down on Disney Plus right now. Like, they've actually, between the whole Gina Carano thing, the end of WandaVision, and now Falcon and Winter Soldier, like, they've lost memberships, they've lost viewers. They were at, I think it was something like 94,000 paid subscribers, or I'm sorry, yeah. It was something like that. It was like 94,000 paid subscribers. They're down to like 86,000 paid subscribers.
Damn.
Yeah. So like they're losing people's interest. People just.
Do you think some of that has to do with people just being marveled out, and then also people dropping their subscription once Mando ended, and they're just like, I don't really care about the Marvel stuff, but I'll get it back when Star Wars stuff comes back. So
probably a little amount, yeah.
I don't think people were marveled out before then. I think that what happened was we were all so excited after Mando.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
When you look at like the timing of everything that's happened since then, I mean, we're looking at the beginning of the year. That's like when all the other shit started popping out. Like WandaVision was like what, second week of January that it started? When you look at that and you soak all of that in together, it's like I think that they coasted a little too hard. There were some problems with Falcon and Winter Soldier because originally a big part of the story was a virus that was sent out into the world poisoning people. And after they had already filmed like all of that shit, everything with COVID started happening, and Marvel made the call to like change the show. So I kind of feel like a big part of Falcon and Winter Soldier not hitting all the buttons that it's supposed to be is because of COVID, because they held back a lot of like what they were trying to do with the story. But also at the same time, like in this last episode, when they're in New York City and she fucking breaks out her phone and starts sending her fucking message out, and everybody else's phones start going off, and like you see in the park people go from like sitting Indian legged style on the fucking grass with like groups of friends that all of a sudden they're standing up and like
flash dance.
They got activated.
And I'm like, this is so fucking bad.
That was pretty cheese, I'll say that
for sure. Dude, and then like every person they showed, there was like, here's angry random white guy in his Canadian tuxedo. And then it was just like group of ethnically diverse people all looking angry and sullen.
It was just like dad.
Sounds like New York.
It's fucking stupid is what it is. Like, just the entire fucking premise, and that this is, you're sitting in a fucking park and all of a sudden all your people are already here and you just activate them with a fucking message through an app. Like,
I will say,
she's the best terrorist in the world.
She's the bestest ever. She's the version of Rey.
I will say I'm way less interested in that whole part of the show than I am with all the I much prefer the John Walker, the Asian, you know.
Yeah, me too.
I like that part of it way more than, like, as far as villains go, I don't have any interest. Like,
what you said about John Walker is right, because it's like, you know, you hate his guts, and then they start breaking into a story, and even though you hated his guts 2 seconds ago, you can't tear yourself away from listening to, you know, him talk about his past and stuff. When he talks about getting a medal that commemorated the worst day of his life, it's like any veteran who's ever had that situation happen to them knows exactly what he meant when he said that. And it's like, that kind of shit really does connect and hit home with lots of people, and, you know, and their family members that understand that as well, you know. So there's potential there, and he's dynamic as a character, and you know, and I did like that little after scene. And then they kind of done a good job actually showing how, you know, he took the serum for the right reasons, but the serum's pushed him over the edge, that he snapped and he's completely lost, you know, touch with, you know, the good person that maybe he was at one time. And his lust for power has pushed him over the edge. And then they showed the little scene at the end with him making his fucking garage style American shield. I thought, okay, actually welded his medals onto it after his discharge. I'm like, that's some significant, you know, visual shit there that, you know, that means a lot. So for that, I give him props.
Like, and then you have the other girl, and I'm just like, ah.
I almost feel like all of that was gaslighting. Well, no, I mean, part of me feels like that was gaslighting to get the military people who would see it like even more invested, and just be like, oh shit, okay, I totally get this, like, yeah, let's fucking melt them down and attach it to our fucking weapon of ass destruction. Like, but also at the same time, I kind of feel like it's also a bit disrespectful to everybody who's gone through that, who's gone through any kind of PTSD from warfare, from military actions, and, you know, like,
it's a tricky statement, and it's political kind of in nature. And they're taking on, like you were talking about, they're taking a lot of woke culture on, especially in this last episode. For better or worse, we're waist deep in it now. Some of it, I guess, I don't know. I like some of it more than others.
One more question, and then we'll get to another smoke break. But they took Zemo to the, which I actually thought that was a good scene too, with Bucky and Zemo in Sokovia. Showing how Bucky was kind of like not, he changed a little bit. I was kind of wondering if he was going to fucking shoot him. But it was a little over dramatic when he dry fired it and then dropped all the bullets. But yeah, we didn't do it. But my question was, they're taking Zemo to the raft, and do you think that is Zemo going to be on the Thunderbolts then? I guess, was he part of the original Thunderbolts? One of the Zemos. Okay.
He was. What's his face? The guy with the mask and the sword and the American flag cape. They made a Marvel legend of him a few years back.
Okay.
Oh yeah, I forgot that dude's name.
Can't remember his name.
Do you think that John, U.S. agent, wind up being on the Thunderbolts team?
Yeah.
Okay. I'm curious about that. To see what they do with that, because the raft is where they hold all the villains, right?
Yeah. My question about that is, why wasn't he in there before?
That's not a bad point. Well, maybe they didn't really consider him like a super villain.
Held in some like mental thing.
I'm wondering if like he got snapped away, and then he snapped back wherever.
That's actually a really good point. They didn't mention whether or not he got snapped.
I have a feeling in this last episode they're going to give us some Baron Zemo answers.
Dude, cool. I hope so, man. He's still in the show, man.
He is very much so.
I mean, and it'd be difficult for him not to, because like, rest of the show is just kind of it's just there.
Yeah. It's milk. It's not wonderful. It's not terrible. It's milk.
Yeah.
Milk. All right, fellas, let's fire it up again.
Yeah. Let's
do that. Kathleen would just beat us over the head with the shit.
It's the same mindset.
I mean, it was awful.
So she's actually getting
like being punished.
Sorry, Wayne.
Same mindset.
I caught Wayne
off. Well, according to Doomcock.
Yeah, was that like
It was interesting because like Doomcock put out two reports and it makes kind of a little bit of sense. Like Doomcock came out and said that one of his sources behind the scenes insinuated that the reason Kennedy is even still there, that the reason that the shareholders haven't, rioted and booted her already is because she has dirt on a certain island about a certain guy that didn't kill himself, pertaining to like the CEOs and higher ups in the company. And then like a few days later, his report is that she's at the fucking front door. I think the fact that the higher ups in Disney hearing the hint that they're somehow tied with Pedo Island was enough to embolden them, possibly, to say, okay, that's, because they can't
sponsor that island.
Whether there's probably I don't know. I'm not going to even talk about it, but
a big part of the connection right there that you're talking about is literally under our noses, and it was part of the Acolyte show. Do you guys remember who the writer of that show is?
No. Mm-hmm.
Harvey Weinstein's former personal assistant.
Oh shit!
I don't think I've ever heard of that show.
Yeah, I mean,
it's the Sith show that's...
Oh, the one that's coming up, you mean. Okay.
Yeah. Oh, okay.
So she's writing it, and she's another woke idiot, but she's 100% also one of Kathleen Kennedy's hires.
Acolyte.
Yeah. So it's basically, from my understanding, is that it's going to be like the dark side equivalent of Rey.
Dark Rey.
Wonderful, because she's so great. Now, the whole, when somebody finally did mention the whole that Kathleen Kennedy created Rey to be her avatar in the movies, it all kind of just like, holy fuck.
Yep.
No wonder. Doomcock, you know, got to give him credit. He puts out a good report. Whether it's all bullshit or not, it was at least entertaining video. First set of videos.
I don't think anything he puts out is bullshit, because if you go back, like,
it really had,
and go through, like, his videos of Star Wars news and stuff that was, like, rumored, like, before The Last Jedi even came out. Like, we were still a couple of months out. And he had videos up talking about, here's some shit that's going to come, and you guys are not going to enjoy this. You're not going to be happy with it. I'm not happy with it. And he's hit a lot of bullseyes ever since. And
there you go. Yeah. Well, it would be nice if the reign of Kennedy was finally at least over and we could move on.
Yeah, because she isn't needed.
Have our own Filoni. Just give them all the Star Wars stuff, and just have them head everything.
I'd be so down for that.
That was part of, like, his last report, is that Favreau, at the very least, is now working unfettered. So
good.
Nobody's on his nuts for what he's producing for Mando or Book of Boba Fett or any of the other shows.
Oh, forgot about that. Oh man.
Yeah, and. There's also talk, and it's still just talk, but there's talk that Gina might even be coming back.
That would be great.
Gina.
That would be
back.
Amazing if they do that.
And there's a precedent for them getting rid of people and bringing them back with James Gunn. So
James Gunn, right, exactly.
And
so it can be done.
One of the other things in I think Doomcock actually pointed this out, and it may have been a couple of weeks ago. Favreau's plans for Cara Dune were actually, they go all the way back to that first episode, her first appearance. That scene, you remember the scene where Baby Yoda chokes her while they're arm wrestling? The reason he choked her is because she was using the Force when they were arm wrestling.
Oh, shit. That's very interesting.
So,
crazy,
they have plans for her. Like, they've always had plans for her as a character.
Damn, she'd become, maybe not like a Jedi, but like a Force user. That'd be great.
I mean, they're that's like part of like the talk of everything, was that it was going to be, she'd be on some kind of path and learning either from Luke or Ahsoka. And it's
I love that, because we all assume that she was going to be the main character of that Ranger, whatever, Space Rangers.
Yeah, for sure.
Space Cops.
That was kind of a given,
Yeah.
Rangers in space.
Well, fellas, let's get into my favorite part of the show. Space Cops. I don't even like Earth Cops. Space Cops. No, Space Cops.
I was like, what the fuck? I'm in, though, dude.
Toy talk, fellas. And before we begin, I didn't know if Wayne wanted to address your talk about anything that you're working on, Gyronaut style. I don't know if you started anything new or anything.
Right on. No, nothing.
Well, let's start with you.
Which gets a hiatus. Well, I want to take a moment to complain about pop collectors and how horrible they are for the culture, and then and then show off the pops that I picked up. This is a death metal Batman Guitar Solo.
That's pretty cool.
It's a PX exclusive. I couldn't help it. It was just cool.
What's PX?
It's like comic stores.
Okay.
It's
Yeah.
It's a distribution magazine that's basically like how the comic shops order all their comics for the month, except it comes out 3 months in advance. So the magazine comes out, you have like a 4-week window of time from the time that comes out to go through all 500 pages of it and figure out what it is you're going to order for your store and then send your order in.
Okay.
And they get exclusives. So
nice. I guess.
means you get a sticker on your death metal Batman, which I think is kind of a cool combination. And I found this Funko 2001 Spring Convention Limited Exclusive Grimlock.
Yeah, boy.
I see that now.
Really cool.
Where do I see that? GameStop, is it? I think.
Yeah. The GameStop thing. And it's number 69, dude.
Oh, shit.
Yes.
I got mine.
So I found a Tusken Raider.
Oh, dope. I got two of them in my stash right now, BBTS.
Yeah. I've got actually my big bad stash is in route. I got the notice today. I've got, and so I'll be showing off the Mega Supreme next week. Yeah.
Oh, that's awesome, man.
I picked up a Gamorrean Guard. I've got my second one coming in the stash this week.
Dope.
And I actually found I've always been interested in these Velociraptors, and my target had them on clearance.
Oh yeah, you can never have too many dinosaurs running around your house.
You know.
I have the Jurassic Park Raptor. I
finally picked up Commander Gree.
Yeah.
In the clone case. I also picked up which one was it? I picked up another clone this week.
Was it Wolf?
Yeah, it was Wolf. That's it.
Wolf. I have that.
Everybody got him on display, so I didn't.
Should be coming any day now. I mean, I see him popping up everywhere, like on the Facebook groups and stuff, and BBTS still hasn't given me my notice that it's came out. It's the last commander that I'm waiting for to have all the ones coming out so far.
I've always, the box that my General Grievous came in is in really good shape, and then I saw this rough box, you know, General Grievous, so I picked up a second Grievous so I can just leave one in box.
Nice. That's a decent
I hate figure, to think that I've become that collector, but maybe for some of the figures I have. I also snagged another Gremlin. I found the Flasher Gremlin. I really like the little jacket that he has. I think I can use it to put on one of the Turtles. And speaking of Turtles and jackets, I actually saw the Turtles in Disguise 4-pack, but I left it because I don't know. I've just set up a Turtles NECA display and I realized I would end up leaving it in the box, and I wouldn't, you know.
Sometimes really you gotta say no. It.
Yeah, just you just gotta draw the line somewhere. Well, I realized after I set up my Turtle NECA display that I've got 9 figures on display and about 19 figures in the collection. So what's the point of continuing to buy more figures if I don't have the space for them? And then last but certainly not least, thanks to my man, Brother Kyle, I'm back on the Beast train, and I've got my Beast Wars Megatron. Totally excited. I just kind of cracked the box this morning because I've been behind on everything, so I haven't had a chance to open him and play with him, but super excited too.
He's a big purple dinosaur, dude.
Hell yeah. Thank you, Brother Kyle.
You're welcome.
And that wraps it up for me.
I'm just ordering one of those from Hasbro Pulse.
It's totally worth it. It's a good figure.
Instead of just trying to find it in store, dude.
I mean, you have the Primal, so you. Speaking of like keeping stuff in boxes, I have that in my Target. There's like 8 or 9 Primals just like shelf warming basically right now, and I'm just kind of like thinking of just grabbing another one just to leave in box. Just
You should have done that last week because they were on sale for $23.99.
Damn. My thinking is that if I ever get a chance to meet at a convention Garrett Jock to have him sign the box, I think that would be fucking phenomenal.
Yeah.
So I might pick one of those up tomorrow if they're still there. Good.
Box figures, is keep them for conventions. That's a good idea.
He seems like a cool dude. I was watching some live interview on YouTube last week with some podcast. I think he's more of like a, what was that show he's in? Stargate. It was like a Stargate kind of podcast, but they talked about everything. He seems like a very personable guy.
Stargate, dude. That shit's on Netflix.
Never watched it. I really should. I love that movie. Kurt Russell. So. And James Spader, too.
Pretty great.
Yeah.
There's a big fandom for Stargate.
Yeah.
Not among it, but, you know.
I heard there's a good show. Chris, what'd you get this week? Robert California. Get anything good, Chris?
Yeah, you got something awesome. A couple of good things this week.
Yeah.
Spider-Bot.
One little Spider-Bot. Didn't come with anything else. Did it come with any accessories?
Yeah, this thing, dude.
That's kind of cool. That's awesome. How is that, like, as far as articulation wise? Because I've been hearing a lot of people talk, like, debating about, like, Hot Toys and how they're not very, like quality wise. Like, you can basically not pose. You're not supposed to, like, pose them in a display. You basically just have to ace dance them. Otherwise, you fuck up the.
That's one of those Hasbro Titan Heroes, right?
Yeah, that's actually kind of disappointing. Like Mando is fine because Mando, you can kind of just like give him, you know, reaching for his gun and kind of just, or walking, and he looks badass. But like with a Spider-Man, you would want to have it like in some sort of awesome dynamic pose, and apparently you're not supposed to do that and keep him like
with
that.
With the suits, with the suits over the bodies, yeah, it can kind of.
Yeah, I guess people were saying that they're better just to pose them, take pictures of them, and just put them back in the hay stance. And that's kind of a little disappointing for a figure that's supposed to be, you know, where it is, like, over $200.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And, like I said, like, Mando's fine because it looks badass. It's just standing there when he's all fun.
It's so sick, man. And the suit is armor. It's not just a regular spider suit. So I love how they're doing the whole under the suit, you know.
Looks really, really good. It actually really comes through on the camera pretty well.
That's cool. I wasn't sure if that would come in or not, but yeah, this thing is fucking so sick, dude.
I have yet to break into Hot Toys.
I got another Roach Boy over the week too.
That thing's awesome, man.
Bruce Lee.
Is that probably the coolest one that you've got? Yeah. I mean, I know you have a couple of those, but I know you're really looking forward to that one.
This one I like the most, dude. He is just the jumpsuit and everything. Like, it's
It's really, really cool. That's awesome, man.
And the heart with the dripping blood.
Yeah, that's really a nice touch. Anything else?
That's pretty much all I got. Yeah.
All right. Let me run through my haul real quick so we can get to all the awesome shit Nico fucking 3D printed this week. I picked up this, which is awesome. It's probably one of my least favorites out of the line, but as far as it being least favorite, I still like it. Actually, you know what? The Wheeljack is probably my least favorite, but this thing's still cool. I mean, I love a tank. I'm a sucker for a tank mode, and you know, he looks like a little deluxe. Deluxe Warpath. So yeah, cool for him.
I kind of felt the same thing about Warpath when I got him.
Yeah, I picked up this thing, which is cool. Really, really awesome.
Yeah,
and I picked this up on Neek's recommendation.
Rusty
really,
boy,
really phenomenal paint job. Like, they went all out with that. And it's a good mold too. I dig it.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
It looks my patience of not getting a Jar Jar came to fruition because I got them for $9 at Target because I knew there was like 10 of them there forever and nobody's buying them. So they're just basically giving them away. But so yeah, now I have a Jar Jar, which whatever, it's cool. It's a good figure actually. It's like, as far as the figure goes, it's very decent. And the accessories it comes with are really cool.
No one wanting a Jar Jar figure, who would have also anticipated that?
Right. also I picked up on clearance at Target.
Get a whole little Gungan army going.
I saw pictures of something like that. A guy had a bunch of them. I got this, which is cool. I waited, and this was a half off. These mugs are expensive as fuck.
Dude, those are nice.
Turvis, these Turvis dude. Things?
Yeah, dude, it's, I have it's one like of those.
Lava hot all day. It's great. I got...
I keep water cold, too.
This thing, because it's a Starscream, the alt mode of this is the most ridiculous thing I've ever seen. But the bot mode's cool. You know, if only they could have done something like this for any of the Bayformer movies, where he actually looked halfway. Oh, he looked like a Starscream. God forbid, right? I picked up this little core class.
The Tetrajet mode on that is.
It's,
I don't know. I find
it's weak as
a little
shit.
Bit offensive.
So dumb, yeah. This little core class Optimus is fine for a little $10 figure. It's a fun little desk bot to keep on here, so I can pick up and mess with. Yeah. I got
desk bot.
I got this thing, which I was pretty excited. Speaking of Bayformers, I never thought I'd be collecting so many of them, but I did get that Megatron, so I bought this to go with it. And the Unique Toys Optimus, it's cool. I like the, you know, it's painted. It's the like battle damage version, so it has like wear on it. But the generation is crazy. What's that? I'd much rather have a clean one. But I'd say aesthetically, it looks good. The transformation, like, is Unique Toys always has crazy ones. It is. It's very well
done. That's good.
This has been one of my favorite figures that I got. My little. Bird Lady Air Razor.
Yeah, this thing's great. You can take a lot of good pictures with that one.
Yeah, it's I mean, she's one of my, like, her and Tigertron are a couple of my favorite characters from Beast Wars. So it's really cool to have this. And I'm pretty sure, well, they definitely are. They announced they're doing a Tigertron. So that's awesome. And then, thanks to my homie Wayne, I got the Netflix Cheetor, which is aesthetically way better than the other one, but still kind of a weird figure. Like, I still feel like if they would have just made these legs go into the leg, it would have been so much better.
I mean, it's everything. It's the whole torso and just...
Yeah.
It's basically just like a spine and empty bits and the cheetah head, and then there's robot head, and then his arms move on pegs. It looked funny.
It's the least best of the Kingdom figures. And I still think, and I'm even saying that than the Fossilizer. I think the Fossilizers have more fun and playability than this thing. But it's Cheetor. It's a Beast War. I still love it.
There's that Pterodactyl Fossilizer that's coming in the next wave.
Yeah, I saw that.
I think that is going to take the place of Cheetor as actually the worst figure in the line. But, yeah. Cheetor is easily the worst figure in the line.
Now, I've heard someone say that all those fossilizers are actually combinable at the end. What is it like?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that's actually... What's that? Does it have a name?
No. I've seen a lot of really, really cool, like, people buy, like, 3 or 4 of those Paleo Traxes and make, like, really awesome... Oh, yeah, you got one. Mm-hmm. Cool.
Yeah.
Oh, I did get Rackalite. I didn't pull them down, but I got one.
The one thing that got to me and like it made me think, oh, maybe I should grab this, is I could do some shots with like kinetic sand and have like Wheeljack scanning the bones and being like, yeah, how about a robot Triceratops?
That's a really good idea.
You know, and then when Studio Series Slag comes out, it'd be like, to introduce those guys, Robot Dinobot Slag.
I am excited about Dinobot Slag.
To be honest with you, 100%.
Have you seen it come out? It looks really good.
Chris, you have to. You already got the Grimlock. You're locked in. You got to get the team on.
You need all 4 of the other Dinobots. You're going to need them. They're coming.
So, real quick, I have one more figure, and then we'll get to Neeks Hall. Just at the behest of you guys, just pounding it into my brain about how amazing the figure is, I picked up the Kingdom Cyclonus, and you guys were extremely right. You were right on all accounts, as you usually guys are when it comes to toys.
Always in my book.
This is the best Kingdom figure that it's probably the best mainline. And we said that about Hot Rod too, but I think this is a little bit better than Hot Rod.
I was honestly surprised it didn't come out as a studio series because the engineering and the quality and everything is so good. And it seems like they're reserving that studio series tag and moniker for, you know, the higher, you know, a little bit higher end figures. And then Jasmine's the studio series cut with all those gaping holes, and Cyclonus ends up in Kingdom. And he's a 10 out of 10. So who knows, but it's fun. And those of us who collect kind of know that, like, okay, if you're putting together an 86 shelf like I am, you need Cyclonus. It doesn't matter what freaking label he's under, you're going to grab him. And he is, he's a 10.
Yeah, like they intend for everybody to buy them all. So, like, the reason why Galvatron and Cyclonus and Rodimus Prime are all in Kingdom is just simply because it's where they could fit them into the budget and have it all coming out in the same year. So the only difference. There isn't a quality difference. They're all, you know, Cyclonus, Verge, Hot Rod, they're all Voyagers.
It's
even Primal.
It's just, you know, it's just kind of funny that I maybe that's retail perception in my mind then. It definitely is then, because it's just like the studio series line, I've always, since they've been coming out, I've always kind of mentally kind of thought of them as a little bit nicer than, you know, your standard shell form, you know, shitbox soap, you know, dispenser trash.
Yeah, I think like the dispenser trash stuff is still like it's still out, like they still do it, but it's all in the cyberverse.
That doesn't offend me. It's like, yeah, if you got a little kid that loves the bright colors and wants a you know, not a collectible quality bot that he can smash out in the gravel road, then hey, have fun.
And the other thing about those cyberverse toys is a bunch of them come with blast effects. Those blast effects, they made them compatible with all the older line stuff, like the Argai stuff, the generation things.
Nice.
So if you ever see any of those on clearance and they have blast effects or any like little parts that you might see, they'd be like, oh, that might be kind of cool. I could use it for this or that or whatever.
That's funny, because as like a parent, you could buy that for your kid and then just take away the blast effects for your collection. So I can't give my kid these little parts. So give me all these guns and blast effects. And you can just have they look like
my kid's a retard. It'll try eating. I have to take
it. All right. Yeah, that's all I got. Neek, what'd you do this week? I know you did a lot.
That thing too, Ractonite. The other reason I picked it up was I figured when I did those, whenever I do get around to doing that shot of Wheeljack scanning it, I'm thinking I'll have the bones like sunk into like kinetic sand, so that it looks like it's been like buried underneath dirt and rock and all that shit.
Yeah, so that looks sick.
Yeah, it'll be fun. That'll be a fun shoot when I do it. So I got Shockwave and his light piping. I'm not sure
if I can see it.
Is it catching? Is it like lighting?
Lower it down a little bit. Yeah, the screen's a little blurry, but I can see the yellow. I can see the light. Looks good. It looks very bright. Oh, the light piping on Cyclonus is cool too, by the way.
Yeah, his is really good as well.
I love light piping.
This motherfucker is a badass.
Yeah, goofy alt mode, but the bot mode is very cool.
Nobody's buying him for that alt. I actually saw that there's a 3D print. There's a file for a gun handle.
Okay. So
that you can transform him into that jet mode or whatever it is.
Shuttle and fucking plank.
Plug on the handle, and then you have straight up G1 shotgun or blah G1 Shockwave gun mode.
That's awesome. Shockwave's such an awesome character.
I also got that Rusty Boy.
Ew. They give him a name, or was it just like Sparkless Bot, right? Something like that.
Mater.
Yeah. Might as well be Mater with his purple eyes. He's got that Twinkie sickness. So then as far as like downloads and prints this week, I'll just like go over some of the stuff I'm really happy with that I did. One of the files that I obtained this week was an upgrade kit for Studio Series Jazz to fill in his calves and his forearms so they don't have, or not his calves, I'm sorry, his thighs and his forearms, so he doesn't have those like big ass gaping holes that used to be there. Instead, you've got a little plank of plastic and a little plank of plastic, and makes his legs and arms look like they're way more filled out.
So, oh yeah, for sure.
Don't do drugs, turkeys.
Scat man.
So there's that one. And that's pretty fun. I like that. And then a gap filler for the chest of Optimus Primal.
Yeah, that's a good one.
You can kind of see there.
Yeah, he needs that.
Yeah, that thing is sick, dude.
Yeah. And like the guy that that actually made it, he painted his black, but I don't think he was making his on a resin printer. And the gray of my resin, it's not a perfect match, but it's close enough that like you cannot notice it and just be like, oh, that's cool. That gap's gone. But so there was that. And then Sunstreaker. I think I did this. I may have done this one last week. This kit was, and actually I still need to print out the spoilers for his vehicle mode. But this kit fills out Sunstreaker's forearms, his thigh, and his calves.
Very nice.
Yeah.
Sunstreaker is great.
Some game changer shit. Like,
yeah, dude, for sure.
Gapson is really fucking dope.
Totally. It's great that you do it yourself because I kind of don't like spending money on stuff like that.
Yeah.
So yeah, it's totally worth it. Like, drop that money on the printer and just fucking get it.
Yeah. Like, I mean, it's the sort of thing that shouldn't happen at all.
Exactly. Yeah.
Like there shouldn't be these kinds of gaps on figures like this.
That's a dope car. Yeah. Yeah. I hate the fact that you have to fix toys. Like it's. Ugh.
Yeah, it gets frustrating. And then the bot that got all the Buku Deluxe upgrados for the week.
That guy's all weapon the fuck out, man.
He is. He's ready to fuck shit up and down.
Love that.
This Siege Sideswipe is rocket launcher on his shoulder there. Was printed by me. Painted by me. The missile in the rocket launcher is actually removable.
That's awesome.
Yeah, it's also a 5mm port. So you can also plug on like the actual blast effects that come with some of the figures and use those effects if you care to. You know, I'm not really big on it, but then I also printed up those big old ham hock of machine gun goodness.
G2 guns.
Yeah, G2 blaster, bullet firing, fucky ups.
Can I just say how awesome G2 Sideswipe is? As far as G2 goes, a lot of those figures were fucking dumb. A lot, like the designs were stupid as shit. But yeah. G2 Sideswipe is fucking great. He was such a badass. He had those spike wheels on his shoulders and the fucking giant machine guns and swords.
Nades and, you know. These big ass guns and shit. Like, he was already ahead of the curve just by being a black Lamborghini in the 90s. Like,
yeah, right. Fuck.
I'm gonna use that. Obviously if it's cool with you, which I'm sure it is. But that picture you took the other day, that was a really good photo. The one with the shockwave in the background and him blasting off.
Yeah.
That was a fucking tense picture.
And then the final armament for Sideswipe of the Week was these Netflix-style forearm lightsaber blade things.
Those are awesome. And you painted those up too, right?
Yep, yep.
Yeah.
Printed them. I actually printed them yesterday, and it's a separate piece. Like, there's that the silver base piece that the blade plugs into. The blade's a separate piece and unplugs from the base. So, like, I can actually print more blades and just do, like, different color blades. Like, I was thinking, I was like, oh, fuck. It's Sideswipe. Why didn't I give him red blades?
That'd be awesome.
Yeah. That blue is fucking sick, though, man.
It does look really good.
Like, that shade of blue is just, like...
It was my favorite color.
It's my clear blue over some Tamiya metallic silver.
Yeah.
Over plutonium paint deep space, because you got to throw it on black before you throw it on the metallic.
I'm very excited to get the 3D parts that you have for me, because I know I always say this with painting shit, but I'll be forced to paint them, because you know they're worthless unless I paint it. So
I mean.
Well, they're not worthless. You know what I mean? The Grimlock ones are fine, but like the Gut Gun, like I have to paint that.
Yeah.
It's a good stepping stone because they're not, you know, it's not a super hard thing to do. So I'm looking forward to that project.
Man, that'll be dope.
Yeah. It's fun stuff. Like, and I mean, like, that's the thing. It's like since that car accident that I was in, like, November, what was it, 2018? Like, my ability to like sit down with like my double zero paint brushes and do like fine details has kind of like just gotten to be like incredibly difficult.
Yeah, fuck.
But like as far as like most of these pieces go, it's like you can do it with a can of spray paint, you know, and if you want to go in with some fine detail and learn to do some of that, you can do that too. But realistically, like once I send you these things, like you'd be able to paint them yourself. Just take it slow and steady. And, you know,
do you use like a putty and like put putty on the other side of it, the part that you don't paint, and then just spray it down, or you just kind of like whole cover it up? And
honestly, it depends on what I'm painting. Like those blades, I used alligator clips and was holding it at the bottom. At the bottom of the blades, there's like a couple of extended pieces, and then you plug the whole thing at the bottom of the blade into the forearm piece.
Right.
When I do that, I'll do both sides, because when it's drying, like I have the alligator clips sticking into a piece of foam so that they can dry vertically. So even if like by chance that I sprayed too much paint on them, it would still just drip down and drip right off.
You know, I know it's like a little quite time consuming and stuff like that, but do you ever think of like doing like a instructional videos and stuff like to show people how to like do any of these things?
I mean, it'd be doable.
Yeah. Because nowadays everybody needs a YouTube video to learn how to do anything, myself included.
Right.
Yeah, it would, a lot of times there's not a lot of ones out there for like paint. There's a lot of ones for like painting like D&D like minis and shit like that. But as far as like weapons and 3D printed stuff, it's, I wish there was more for Dios too. That would be really good. I'd love to watch an instructional video on how to like making them trees that you made or something like that, or even like cutting the foam that you have. Those would be really awesome.
There's a bunch of videos up there on all of that stuff. But yeah, I don't know. Maybe I'll do that one of these days. I'd need to get like one of those neck wearable things to hold my phone so I can record actually paint stuff and just be like, this is what I mean when I say a light dusting.
That, exactly, yeah, like stuff like that. Well, I'm enjoying all the stuff that you're doing. seems like with the you're always putting shit out, but like with the Transformers and your 3D printing over the past like couple months, like you've just been like dropping shit fucking everywhere.
It's so much fun.
Yeah.
It literally changes every aspect of your collecting into I am toy god now. I can do really, as long as it fits on that build plate, I can do it. You know? And it's like, I saw in one of my 3D printing groups, there's a guy who has a resin printer my resin printer, like the printing bed, is about the size of my cell phone. So, for example, for you guys, it's about the size of your cell phones too. Mm-hmm. They're all going to be about equally the same size. This dude has a resin printer, and he was printing a translucent mixed with glow-in-the-dark resin tiger on a bed plate that was like a foot and a half long and a foot and a half wide. And when he posted like what the model is that he got, like I had to look up the price, and the price tag on it was like $4,000. And I'm just like, oh, I wish I had the money for that printer, because it's a giant resin printer and you'd be able to do anything. Like you'd be able to do Mando buckets if you wanted to, you know, you could literally do everything and anything. And
God, that'd be so dope.
Yeah. And I mean, I'm not sure if you'd want a Mando helmet in resin, because that could actually probably be very problematic. I didn't even think about it. Because like your head sweats, your head gets hot, you're wearing a resin helmet. What if it starts melting while you're wearing it and like dripping down your mouth into your eyes? Oh my god, you could go blind. Like,
put a warning label on it, you'll be fine.
So maybe not helmets, but demos and big shit, and you know, but it's amazing. Like it really is like just a crazy experience in like, you know, okay, let's go to the store, see if they have anything new. No, nothing new? All right, fuck it. Let's go back home and let's print something new.
Do it myself.
You know? It's kind of like that, putting that gauntlet on and be like, bitch ass Ronin. Fuck you.
Toy God's a good way to put it.
Yeah,
I control all the toys.
This is my universe. It's almost like, you know, depending on your point of view, you're either Primus or Unicron. You
know? Maybe a little bit of both.
Yeah, maybe a little bit of both.
He wants to be light and dark side.
Sure. You know, maybe
gray Jedi.
Because I got to eat too. You know? Yeah, you motherfuckers want your accessories, but I gotta eat.
That's
right. Unitron looks tasty as fuck.
On that note, I think we can wrap it up. This was a good one, guys. I liked it. Like, subscribe, and share. Hit that stupid little notification button just so your phone can ding whenever I put these out. Cup the balls. Well, yeah, cup the ball. Always cup the balls. That's our motto. It's actually our motto. Our slogan. We'll make some t-shirts.
101.
Do all that stuff. And this has been another episode of the Mandablorians. This is the way, and I have spoken.